We are in a state of emergency.
Imagine. Wrote a song about it, like to hear it, then go.
Free your mind.
Mr. Jones owned a cotton plantation and many slaves. One day he was talking to the owner of the plantation next to his, and Mr. Jones was lamenting the fact that times were tough, he was having to work his slaves harder than ever, and was having trouble with some of them being disobedient or trying to run away. The other plantation owner said he knew someone who could help.
Day one.
One day Mr. Jones called his slaves together so a man named Mr. Smith could talk to them. Before beginning, Mr. Smith whispered to Mr. Jones, "Whatever I say, do not contradict me or interfere, and I promise you your slave troubles will end." "My name is Mr. Smith," he said to the slaves, "and this may be the happiest day of your lives. From today forward, you will no longer be slaves, but free men." Mr. Jones was so shocked he started to step forward, but Mr. Smith gestured for him to remain silent. He did, only because the other plantation owner had spoken so highly of Mr. Smith's skills. You are no longer the property of Mr. Jones, Mr. Smith continued. You are free. No more would you be forced to labor for the benefit of Mr. Jones. Now you can work for yourselves. Now the slaves were all murmuring and looking at each other. Many were smiling, many were looking puzzled. In fact, you are now free to leave the plantation whenever you want, Mr. Smith said. However, since we are surrounded by other plantations, if you leave, some other plantation owner will likely claim you as his own the moment you set foot on his property. So I urge you not to risk your newfound freedom by doing something so foolish. Instead, I suggest that you stay here, no longer as slaves, but as willing participants and part owners of this plantation. Yes, this is now your plantation. Mr. Jones bit his tongue to keep from objecting. For now, we might as well leave Mr. Jones in charge, said Mr. Smith, since he is the only one with any experience at running a plantation, which is quite a complicated thing to manage. But he will no longer be your master, but just another worker on the plantation. In fact, he will now be using his organizational and management skills to serve you. Whatever problems you may have had with him before, you are now all equals, and you need each other to make this work. If we all cooperate and work together, we can all reap the benefits together. In honor of this happy occasion, I present you this new symbol of togetherness and cooperation, this flag, which shall be the emblem of the new free Jones Plantation. He held up the new flag, but most of those listening were still too amazed to respond. And this shall be our motto, Mr. Smith announced. We work together as free men for our mutual benefit, pledging our allegiance to the Jones Plantation, which stands for prosperity, liberty, and justice for all. To celebrate, everyone has the rest of the day off. Enjoy your freedom, do as you please, and be back here tomorrow morning, bright and early, so that we may begin work on this great and noble new endeavor as equal free men. Finally convinced that Mr. Smith was serious, the former slaves applauded and cheered.
Day 2.
We all want this plantation to do well, Mr. Smith said at the beginning of the next meeting, so we can all share in the benefits. We all know that it takes a lot of effort to make a cotton plantation work. Just because you're all free doesn't mean you can stop working. In fact, since you're now working for yourselves, I expect you to work even harder than ever before, but now with pride and joy, knowing that you're working for yourselves. Of course, there still have to be rules. If everyone just does whatever he wants, the plantation won't produce anything. This experiment will fail, and we'll all starve. You should be thankful that Mr. Jones has agreed to stay on, to lend his knowledge and skills to this endeavor, and I trust you will all do your own part to make this work. Several of you have been chosen to act as project supervisors, to manage different aspects of the operation, to make sure everyone is doing his assigned job, to make sure that the rules are followed, and so on. The rest of you may head out to the fields to start your first day of work as free men.
Day 3.
The next morning, Mr. Smith had a grim expression on his face as the daily meeting began. "I have an unpleasant duty to do today," he said. "Yesterday, Charles was caught keeping some of the cotton he picked, presumably to sell for his own personal profit. That is against the rules. That is stealing. For that, Charles must be punished." Two men tied Charles to the whipping post. "I take no joy in this," Mr. Smith continued, "but you must understand, if we do not maintain order, if we do not have rules that we all abide by, then the plantation will fail, and we will all suffer." The whip cracked against Charles' back. "But if we all pitch in for the common good, then we can all prosper. Being free doesn't mean you should be selfish and greedy. We must each do our assigned duties and obey the rules, and then we can all benefit, and each of you will receive your appropriate share of the profits." A young man named Samuel stepped forward. "But if you and Mr. Jones decide the rules and whip us if we disobey, how is that any different from what we had before?"
"How can you say that?" Mr. Smith asked. "I'm shocked. You were a slave before, and now you're free. Things still need to be managed and organized by those best qualified to do so. Do you know how to run a plantation, Samuel?"
"Well, no," he answered. "But if we're free, why do we get no say in what the rules are and how things work?"
"I'm surprised at your ingratitude," Mr. Smith answered. "None of you know how a plantation is run, so you're in no position to be making decisions about how things are done here. You don't seem to appreciate all the things that Mr. Jones provides for you, from protecting you from all the outside threats that you know nothing about, those who would come here capture and enslave you if not for Mr. Jones' protection, to making sure that you all have food and housing, tools to work with, that you're cared for when sick and injured, and so on. There wouldn't be a plantation at all, no cotton to pick, no land to plant and harvest, if not for him. You should be grateful that he's made possible the level of comfort you now have. Your lives would be far worse if not for him. Nevertheless, as free and equal participants in this endeavor, from now on at each meeting,
Any worker may have 2 minutes to ask questions or voice suggestions or complaints. With that, the workers all seemed satisfied and headed out again to the fields to pick the cotton.
Day four.
I have a big announcement, Mr. Smith said as the daily meeting began. Mr. Jones' cousin is here, and not just to visit and see how our project is coming along. It has been decided that from now on, you will be deciding who will manage the plantation. Of course, this job can't be done by just anyone, but every 3 months we will have a special meeting at which all the workers will vote on whether we think Mr. Jones should run the plantation or whether we think his cousin, Mr. Johnson, should run the plantation. That means that ultimately you are in charge because you will be deciding which man you want running things on your behalf. If you don't like the way things are being managed, you now have the power to change it. Amazed and pleased, the workers headed out again to the fields to pick the cotton. Days passed, months passed, a year passed, and the plantation continued to operate as before. Sometimes Mr. Jones was in charge, sometimes Mr. Johnson was in charge, but the day-to-day routine stayed exactly the same. The workers worked hard, long hours every day, and still had little to show for it. Every day the meeting would begin with them all reciting the Jones Plantation motto, "We work together as free men for our mutual benefit, pledging our allegiance to the Jones Plantation, which stands for prosperity, liberty, and justice for all." One day Mr. Smith announced, "Samuel is asked to say a few words this morning, and whatever the rest of us may think of his ideas and opinions, we are all free here, and that means we are all allowed to speak our minds. So, Samuel, you have 2 minutes. Begin." Samuel stepped forward, looking scared. "I was excited when all this started," he began, glancing nervously at Mr. Smith and Mr. Jones. "But don't you all see what's happened here? Nothing has changed. We're all still slaves." There were grumbles of disagreement from the crowd. "They tell us what to do and whip us if we don't. They still make all the rules and punish us if we disobey. They let us make suggestions and complain about things, but they never really change anything. They let us choose between Mr. Jones and Mr. Johnson, but what's the difference? The situation stays the same. We do all of the work, and they take as much as they want and decide how much they'll let us keep. They live in luxury, made rich by the cotton we pick. We do all the work and have to build our own huts, grow our own food, and take care of ourselves. They leave us just enough that we don't revolt or run away. This is not freedom. We're all still slaves. They've only changed the words they use, but nothing else has changed. They say we're all free and equal, but we're not. They command, and we obey. That's not freedom. That's not equality. They say we're free to leave, but all that means is that we're free to be someone else's slave. Why should we work or obey the rules? We didn't agree to this. They made the system. They forced it on us. They control and rob us and call it freedom. They've deceived you into thinking that being able to choose which slave master you'll work for is the same as being free. It's not. Open your eyes. If you keep what you produce, they call it stealing. When they take what you produce, they call it sharing and fair distribution. Can't you see that this is all..." "Your time is up, Samuel," Mr. Smith announced calmly. At his gesture, two supervisors grabbed Samuel by the arms and led him to the whipping post. "I'm sorry, Samuel, but you've broken the rules. There are rules against encouraging others not to work and encouraging others to break the rules. You're only hurting all of us with your discontentment and your complaining and your disobedience." The whip fell, and Samuel let out a grunt. "Without rules, without order, all would be lost. Without law, there would be chaos. We can't just behave as wild animals, each doing whatever he pleases. We must all follow the plan and all do our duty for the betterment of everyone. And those who do not must be punished." The whip fell again, and blood flowed freely from Samuel's back. "Samuel, it is you who are stealing from the others. When you don't do your assigned work, you are making more work for others. When you disobey the rules, it is you who are endangering the future of everyone else here. You are the thief. You are the criminal. You are the one trying to destroy the arrangement that keeps us all safe and prosperous." At every lash of the whip, the other workers cheered louder and louder, some yelling curses at Samuel. "Being spoiled and selfish, you complain about everything, talking as if you're oppressed. But you are the one ruining things. You are the one keeping us from being all we could be. It is your greed and your rebelliousness that is hurting all of us. They all play by the rules," Mr. Smith said, gesturing at the others. "What makes you think that you don't have to? You think you're above the law? There were loud yells of agreement as the whip fell again. We must maintain order, Mr. Smith proclaimed, to make this plantation great, to make it so that we can all be happy and prosperous. To have the society we want, there have to be rules. We all have to contribute our fair share to this great endeavor, and we cannot tolerate actions and attitudes that seek to undermine the amazing things that together as free men we have achieved and will continue to achieve. Mr. Jones was smiling as he gave Mr. Smith a pat on the back. The crowd was cheering so loudly that none of them had noticed that Samuel had died.
All right, so there you have it. There it is. Video, well, actually, it's two videos. The first one gives my song. We're going to talk about the My Song video in a little while, but I'm going to talk about the second one, which is Mr. Smith talks to the slaves. And again, that's what I was trying to describe a couple of videos back. With this, Mr. Smith is a character that's supposed to be like almost like a Willie Lynch type character. But, the way he shows Mr. Jones how to control the slaves is, you know, unorthodox and something different, as we can see. And actually what it is, it's really a parody, you know, which is describing how the political system works, you know, how it really works, you know, and what's really behind the intent of people who control the system for us as black people and people of color and those who are not of the 1%, elite 1%. This is how it really works. This is what the true intent of your inclusion is. Again, to make you believe something that's not true. To give you a sense of empowerment and entitlement that you don't really have. And we still believe it, and we're going to believe it to the very fucking end. And so I think this is an excellent little video that really describes in a nutshell the extent of the power and control we really have as so-called black people in this political system, no matter what you do, no matter what direction you move. You see? And they talked about how it didn't make a difference. And actually, we're talking about Democrats and Republicans, how it really didn't make a difference. Who was in power? But the rules are the same. We still got beat. We still got tortured, no matter what we do. No matter who gets to speak, you know, we get to speak and we say the wrong thing. Again, they talk about my cheap talk sayings, freedom of speech. What does it mean? You can talk all you want as long as you don't say nothing. Like the slave Samuel in that little clip, he said something. And what happened to him? He wound up dead. He was free to speak. As long as he didn't speak against the game that was being played on his people. As long as he didn't speak against that, he was fine. But as soon as he spoke against the game, they beat him to death. And that could have been, you, Dr. King, Malcolm X, we can go on. Yes, well, we can't go too far. We'll just say Dr. King, Malcolm X. But I think that's an excellent, excellent way to describe our situation as it pertains to our role in the political system of this nation. And why we should be talking about creating our own system, which we don't want, because we don't want any real freedom, like the rest of these minority motherfuckers who crawl over here like fucking starving rats and want to get to start talking shit and beg to die and have their motherfucking brains knocked out. Now I'm kind of going off. I'm kind of flashing a little bit, so I got to apologize for that. I'm flashing back, and I'm having some flashbacks. So you know, I do that from time to time. You know, but some people, again, just can't be talked to at all. They can't be reasoned with. It's like trying to talk to a dog with fucking rabies. And when you're dealing with a dog with rabies, there's only one or two things that you can do. Either kill it or get the fuck away from it. But you have some rabid dogs who attack you and they bite you and they infect you with their shit. And so it it winds up a situation where you and they both wind up dead any fucking way, so it don't even really matter. I don't even know how to say this shit, but anyway, let me stick to this video. I didn't even get a video name. It said politics and a Negro. Yeah, that's how the shit really works. That's what it really, that's the true meaning of our role in the political system. And people can say, now I was watching CNN a little earlier, and they alluded back to the 2000 election. I should have pulled up that clip. I wish I could find. Matter of fact, I have, I just don't know where it is. It's a Congressional Black Caucus. All the black congressmen, they call them the Congressional Black Caucus, got together and protested the stealing of the election of 2000. And it was a stolen election. There's no question about that. They protested it. And all they needed was one white senator, because all senators were white back then, one senator to sign off on their grievance, and they could have had their case brought before the Supreme Court. They couldn't get one white senator out of how many senators up there? I don't know how many. It's a bunch of them motherfuckers. Okay, I don't know the number. They couldn't get one to sign off on this shit. They all got up there protesting. Oh, we protested, bloody soul shit. Nothing. They couldn't move shit. Oh, but they're free. They got a caucus, and they got supposedly have power. I'm sure they get some things done, like, you know, street lights changed and garbage cans. You know, they get extra garbage cans put on your block and shit like that. They can get that done. But as far as something as important as the president, they can't do shit. They're about as powerless as a piece of wet toilet paper. Again, it describes to the T, you know, the extent of our true power in under the system. Now, because you obviously have this, you have a large population, again, that's silent white, but somebody tell me about, do you have some black? Yeah, of course you do. You have some Negroes that are just like the Negroes in the story you just heard about, the story I told you about, the Mr. Smith. They were willing to participate. It sounded like a great idea to them. Hey, man, we're free, and we can decide what happens here. Oh yeah, let's do it. But it's all the same shit. And so they can get down if they want to, because they don't know where they because Negroes are lost. Negroes are lost. They have no idea where the fuck they are at all. We don't. You say you do, you're a fucking liar. You were blinded. They put a blindfold on you. They stripped you of every motherfucking thing that makes you a normally functioning human fucking being outside of this system. You cannot function outside of this system. And if you can't, let's see you do it. It's not going to happen. That's like a motherfucker with a broke leg, with two broken legs trying to walk without crutches. That's how you would be. No, but we want to play. We want to pretend. We want to make up stories. We want to lie to ourselves about where we really are, what we really have. And we can do that until it all comes crashing down around our motherfucking hard, nappy fucking heads. And it will. It will. These white motherfuckers, I'm telling you, they're gearing up. And again, I got to keep going back to Germany. I wish I could think your name right now. I didn't get your name. I'm gonna apologize for that. But he posted a couple of videos in the comment section of my last video dealing with Germany. The one I gotta watch this one, which is the story of this black, I believe it was a man, either male or female, who grew up in Nazi Germany, and he or she is telling this story. I definitely gotta watch that. Then he showed me posted another video. I gotta watch both of them. So I'm gonna thank you. I'm gonna get your name. I'm definitely going to talk about it in the next video. Well, thank you for leaving that. It's excellent videos that you left. Now, but again, going back to Nazi Germany, you got to go back to it. And we got to go back to the German people of Germany and look at the contrast of their behavior from one period to the next. We're in the early 1920s, you know, 1923, 24, 25. I mean, again, if you were black, and you want to go to Germany in the early 20s, oh man, you go to, it'd be like being in France. You'd have a good time. Enjoy yourself, party, German people would embrace you, have fun with you, because everybody, you know, the money was flowing, they were doing well, the economy was pumping real good. You know, they were doing the same thing now we're doing now, because they had that debt, the outstanding debt, like I told you, they had to pay reparations for World War I. They were doing that, but they were doing it by borrowing money from the United States and other countries in order to pay that debt off. And then, you know, so they were kind of doing the same thing we're doing now, living under a fiat currency, a currency that wasn't backed up by anything but thin air. So they were partying, have a good time. You go there, enjoy yourself. No, they were, and German people, beautiful people, man. They're beautiful, friendly, loving people, right? And under normal circumstances, when everything is functioning normally, and they can see again, they got a job, they got a house, they can pay their bills, they see a light in the tunnel for their children. Warm and friendly people. They have no, you see as far back as 1908 when Jack Johnson went to Germany with his white wife. I played a clip from time to time. Yeah, in Germany, in the beer garden with his white wife in 1908. And the German soldiers all around embraced him and, you know, tell him how much they loved him and what a great champion he is. In 1908. But what happened in 1933? A fucking flip, a switch. It's like somebody flipped the fucking switch. Somebody flipped the switch and the whole thing flipped to something that nobody could ever believe. The German people transformed themselves into something that hopefully will never, well, I can't say that because we're going to see it again. And they became one in their desire under the power of Hitler to take over all of Europe. And they damn near took over the world. Damn near. This is how together they were. This is how strong they were. This is how it technologically advanced the German people were. But they could subjugate all of Western motherfucking Europe and put it under their boot. Right? And again, this is the same people. No, they didn't fall out of space. The same people that would have embraced you in 1920, 21, 22, would have put you in a fucking concentration camp and gassed you in 1933, 34, and 35. And wouldn't have thought shit about it. What happened? What happened to make that change? You better think about this, Negro. You better think about this. You haven't seen it yet in this country. We are a brand new, freshly made fucking people. Born and bred to be slaves. Created in slavery. Yeah, we're indigenous as slaves. We don't want to accept this. We don't want to grow up to this. We want to pretend and lie to ourselves about where we really are. You can do that. You can play make-believe. Look at me, I'm a cowboy. Look at me, I'm an astronaut. When you're in the comfort of your mother, your father's house, and you know, dad's got a good job and mom's working too. They have two incomes and you're living comfortably and you're just a 6-year-old running around, playing and having fun because dad's got a job, mom's got a job, and all you have to do all day is fucking pretend and play make-believe like the American Negro. But what happens when mom and dad lose their good jobs? What happens when mom and dad can't pay the rent anymore? Playtime is over. Pretend time is fucking over. Make-believe, the world of make-believe and fantasy that the Negro lives in is fucking over. And something else comes into effect that we haven't never seen before. I've talked about it. Somebody asked me about the term I came up with, which is called permafuck. Permanently fucked. This is what we're moving toward. This is what this European has ultimately brought us to. He has permanently fucked us. And if you can't see it, don't want to see it, don't try to see it, don't see it, don't know shit. Sit your motherfucking monkey ass right there. Don't move. Because you will feel it. You may not see it, you may not hear it, but you will feel it. These white motherfuckers gearing up, 70 million behind them, probably more than that. And they're actually making shit happen. They're actually getting shit done. This shit ain't over. I thought it was, but it's not. So it's not just Donald Trump, as Mike Son said, being a coward and all this other shit. He has the whole fucking Republican Party behind him. Filing lawsuits and then all kinds of shit to try to get this election overturned. And he also has that silent white majority. Fuck the niggas. Them motherfucking niggas. Them niggas don't. Niggas is just retarded for no fucking reason. If you think a white motherfucker gonna sit up here and let you just, you gotta be out your motherfucking mind. And this one nigga's out his fucking mind. No, of course not. No, nobody's gonna say they hate you. Nobody's gonna say they despise. Nobody gonna say it to your face. They're gonna pat you in the back, call you buddy and pal. Hey, pal. Hey, buddy. And you're dumb. Hey, pal. Hey, buddy. Hey, brother. Stupid motherfucker. Dumb son of a black heart. Black fucking black. Anyway, let me. I don't wanna get off into that. But so this is who we are. And going back to that video I showed you, I mean, it lays the whole thing out perfectly about exactly what our situation is in terms of our relationship to the political systems of this nation. It's all a rigged game. They go back to 2000. A clearly stolen election. But stolen for what? Why'd they steal it? Well, in order to figure that out, you got to go back to September 11th, 2001 to be able to see that. So all these shit-talking bitches and all you other motherfuckers trying to tell me about whatever, fuck you. You're a piece of garbage. You're cannon fodder, motherfucker. You're a farm animal. You're a fucking farm animal at the end of the day. Chewing your fucking cud, waiting to be taken to the fucking slaughter. And it may be happening now. But I'm telling them, nigga, you ain't home, nigga. You ain't home. You ain't safe. Ain't nothing over here except in your nappy fucking hard head. And if you're not getting ready to make some real moves, I'm not talking about fucking get a job, make some money, and some other fucking nigga bullshit. I'm talking about creating your own fucking nation, your own political system, your own system of living, and doing some real, make some real adjustments in your thinking and living, you'd be better off dead. It's raining men, hallelujah, it's raining men. And I don't mean like that. But I see it. Yeah, it's going to be raining men, women, and children one day. Raining down off a building. You have to look up to make sure nobody fall on your fucking head. That's how bad it's going to get. That's what they're going to bring this motherfucker down. They got to. They got to collapse the whole thing. The whole thing has to be collapsed. The whole system has to be collapsed in order for it to be reshaped and resized to something more, something that's more functional and something that's more sustainable than what we have right here now. Motherfuckers crawl over here, don't know where the fuck they're. Hey, America, lady, I like to be in America. You're backward ass motherfucker. You ought to be somewhere in a sugar, chopping sugar cane stinking bitch. Ain't nothing free here. You got to pay. If you don't pay, bitch, your kids gonna pay. If your kids don't pay, your grandkids gonna pay for it. Somebody gonna pay. Free your ass. Free your ass. Ain't nothing free. And so, you know, I want to talk about this in light of this new information about Donald Trump and the people that back him. Politicians and lawyers, you know, people that's supposed to know. It's gonna be, it ain't over. It is not over. And now you're talking about COVID. This COVID shit is exploding out of, well, it has been. And again, why don't they wear masks? I mean, gee, aren't they afraid of dying? And well, look who's most affected by this COVID-19 shit. Look at the population of so-called Americans that are dying and that are most damaged by this COVID shit. Whenever they show somebody, most of the time, when they show a motherfucker that's dead or dying from COVID-19, it's either somebody black or Hispanic. Very rarely you see a white motherfucker on TV. The youngest motherfucker that died of COVID was black. The oldest victim that died was black. That's why they didn't wear a fucking mask. That's why they don't wear one. Because they know it's affecting you most. And they said, no, just sit, but no, nigga. Don't move. Don't you fucking move. Sit your motherfucking black ass right there. Sit your fucking content, self-satisfied, black dirty ass right there. Don't think, don't move, don't adjust. Just be satisfied where you are right now. Are you comfortable, nigga? Are you having a good time? You look good. Love the shoes. Nice hairdo. Is that your car, nigga? Gee whiz. Is that your house? Wow. Ain't you a real big fucking deal? About to be wiped off this motherfucker. It should be. Get the fuck out of here. Along with the rest of you minority stinking motherfuckers. Powerless pieces of worthless fucking shit. You got it? Motherfucker. So, I'm just flashing. I'm thinking about some things, man, that make no sense, that people have done against me. And it's okay. It's just fine. People have a right to express their opinion. People want to express their opinion about me. I got an opinion, too, about you that you might not want to know. But see, if I express my opinion about these motherfuckers, well, let me just say it won't be a good thing for either one of us. And I'll say to any stinking bitch, white, black, purple, pink, I'm capable of doing anything up in my mind and my fucking will to. Fuck you. Doubt that. Put that past me. I want you to do that. Anything up my motherfucking mind and will to, I can do. I can get done. It ain't no fucking stinking fucking nigga, spit, or broke, working slob, fucking filthy white bitch can take that away from you. Although they're going to try. Although they've tried and failed. Because I'm still rolling like the motherfucking river, nigga. I'm still rolling like the river, motherfucker. Right to your fucking front door. And so I just wanted to make this video talk about that video that I've been trying to remember, and I couldn't remember what it was talking about. But again, it turned out to be much better and more informative than I thought it would be in explaining, you know, our current and future situation as it pertains to politics. There's no way on God's earth that a master is going to allow his slave to take over his system, the system that he created. There's no way that a master is going to let his slave control his plantation or decide what happens on his plantation. It's not going to happen. Now, he has to give you the illusion. He has to create an illusion and a fantasy in your mind that this is what's act, that you can actually do this. He has to make you believe. He has to make you believe, make believe, that there's something, that you're making some kind of changes when you really ain't doing the same shit, but being controlled and being put in a situation where they can finally get rid of your fucking dirty ass, which they should do because they destroyed you. All you minority, mother, fuck Spanish, well, fuck where you from. You've been destroyed and turned to something better off dead at the end of the day. Fuck you. Mina what, nigga? Mina what, motherfucker? What part of Spain are you from, you stinking bitch? No. That's the conqueror's language. That's the motherfucker that conquered you and fucked you and raped you into existence. That's his language, bitch. Mina. Fuck me, the motherfucker. So, I'm going to start to rant even more than I really want to. And I don't want to rant more than I already have. I want to...
I keep it real!
What, dear?
Because I keeps it real like that.
I keeps it real.